of the Italian Society of Statistical Physics. Today we have two speakers, Giulia Pulvano and Onofio Mazzarisi. We start with Giulia and let me introduce briefly her career. I mean, she got a bachelor's degree in physics at La Sapienza University in Rome. And then she got a master's degree in physical complex system at University of Torino. And she's currently doing her PhD. She's in the last year, the PhD, in the public health at Sorbonne University and Inserm under the supervision of Vittoria Colizza. And Giulia research is primarily devoted to data-driven mathematical and computational modeling to study the spread of infectious disease. And of course, due to that, she has been very much involved in the modeling of COVID pandemic. So please, Giulia.
Thank you so much for inviting me. It's such an honor to be here and to present my work. I will share my screen.
Yes, please.
Voilà. Okay, can you see?
Yes, we can see.
Great. So today I decide, since I devoted last year to work on the assessment of COVID pandemic, I decide to talk about this experience this year. And I want to talk about how we used multi-source data and transmission models to fight in general epidemics, but in this case, how we use it to fight COVID-19 epidemic in France. In general, a human-to-human disease transmission is a phenomenon resulting from the interaction among individuals. Since the new infection emerges in a location, it may lead a chain of infection, then generating an outbreak. Then this outbreak can be localized in space or spread a national level and, in the worst case, worldwide, generating a pandemic. And this is what we experienced with COVID-19, that in less than 1 month reached all the provinces in China and then arrived in most of the country in the world, generating hundreds of millions of cases at the moment globally. What I want to show you is the epidemic acceleration that we are experiencing in the last century. As you can see in the plot, you have on the x-axis the days since the first reported case globally, and on the y-axis you have the number of countries reporting at least one case. You can see the orange curve is COVID-19 pandemic that compared with the previous pandemic in the last centuries as swine flu and Spanish flu was deeply faster. In fact, in less than 90 days, it reached more than 200 countries in the world. Why this acceleration? First of all, this is so alarming. And the reason behind that is the increasing of human mobility in terms of connection among locations and in terms of traffic. So our role our epidemiologists and modeler is to understand human mobility in this sense to any associated risk in the spatial spread and use model for track potential chain of infection and to help government and health institution to be prepared to face emerging epidemic and also to respond at an ongoing epidemic. That is what we did basically during this year in the assessment of COVID. Here in this plot, I reported for France the daily hospital admissions over time. As you can see, we faced three waves, as in Italy, and the gray shadow area are the lockdown that the government put in place to mitigate the epidemics. Basically, during all this time window, since the beginning of the first wave, we work trying to help government and health authorities to mitigate the epidemics. What we did basically was, for instance, quantify the efficacy of the intervention put in place or quantify the expected impact of the potential further intervention. For the seminar, I decided to present you two work that we did to fight the pandemic in the during the first wave. The first one is a work that we did during the first national lockdown. It was an analysis on human mobility that we did to quantify the efficacy of travel restriction. And the second work that I want to present you is in exit of the first national lockdown. And in this case, we use some modeling to quantify the under detection of cases, symptomatic cases, in May and June. Let's start from the first work. I think that quantify human mobility reductions during the first national lockdown, it was such interesting because first national lockdown in France, as in Italy, was more strict compared to the other. Let's say it's the worst, the strictest things that government can do as everything was closed. So it's like a nuclear option. So quantify the reduction during the first national lockdown provide the maximal an upper bound, let's say the maximal efficacy that travel restriction can do. To quantify travel restrictions, we use mobile phone data. Mobile phone data have been largely used to quantify mobility fluxes in last decades and have been validated as a good proxy to quantify it. Especially in this year of emergency during COVID, researchers stressed a lot on the use and on the sharing of this data to fight the epidemic. In France, we collaborate with Orange, that is the major national operator, and they provide the near real-time mobility flux in France among geographical location. And so we use that for our analysis. Here I reported the analysis that we did aggregated at France at national level. So you have in the y-axis the total number of trips over time, as you can see. The black dot are the data provided from Orange. And so we have we plot both all trips in France and only the long trips, that are the trips longer than 100 kilometers. As you can see, both show a seasonality pattern before the implementation of lockdown. So we fit this pattern and then we look at the variations from the data to the fit to quantify the variations on mobility, and we found a reduction of mobility of all trips that was 65% during the lockdown, and a variation the long trips that was 85%. So it means that we experienced a such efficient restriction, especially in long range links that are the most dangerous from an epidemiological point of view, because if you connect long range location and maybe they present a different viral activity, this kind of links can create the seeding events. Then what we did was looking at regional level, and we found different heterogeneities on the mobility reduction. For example, as you can see, the Île-de-France, the region of Paris, show during the lockdown a reduction of 70%. That is not the case of other region that present a reduction lower than 55%. Why? This was strange because the national rule was the same everywhere. So we tried to understand these differences, and we found some correlation with socioeconomic and demographic and epidemiological indicator that I will present you. Here I reported the scatter plot on the correlation. On the x-axis, you find the indicator, and on the y-axis, you have the reduction in mobility. In this case, we have the mobility going out of the region, but we performed also internal at the region. And in any scatter plot, you have the Pearson coefficient and the associated p-value. Then the dot are the regions. So in these two cases, we have found a positive correlation with the percentage of workers in active age and with the percentage of work highly affected workers. This is quite intuitive, as mobility fluxes are mostly made up by commuting fluxes. So basically, the region that present highest mobility variation are the region that have an higher percentage of workers, especially highly affected, in highly affected category. Then we found other two interesting correlation, more intuitive. And one is a correlation with the standard of living. So region where people has high salary are the region that reduce more the mobility during the lockdown. We interpreted the result as the fact that white collar job have the possibility to more likely to perform their work remotely. And this is not the case that blue collar job. And also richer people can also decide to stay at home if they are sick or scary, as they can manage financial loss. So they have more opportunity compared with blue collar job. And this is an interesting result that it was also found in Italy and in US. Finally, the last correlation that we found was with the number of individuals hospitalized with COVID-19. What does it mean? It means that region most affected by the disease are the region that present an higher reduction. And basically, we interpret these results as the fact that people that live in most affected region most carried about the disease, and so they were more compliant. It's like it's a sort of risk aversion, so a behavioral adaptation to the epidemic. And this is a result that was found also in another context in a study of the West Africa Ebola epidemic. So all the this correlation, and however the discrepancies among regions suggest us that maybe we have to think to more targeting restrictions instead of a restriction national level. As for example, what we suggest was to during the first lockdown we didn't have possibility to pharmaceutical intervention. We didn't have vaccination, so a possibility was to improve, for example, the surveillance system in place that we know that present a lower reduction in mobility. In this way, we can balance the differences of among regions in the efficacy of the lockdown. So this is an example of a work that we did using the mobility analysis. Now let's jump at the modeling part. I want to first to present you the modeling that we designed and developed for studying COVID epidemic, and then I will explain how we use this model for a particular context that was to quantify the underreporting. This is the model. It is an age-structured transmission model. We decide to use an age structure model as COVID pandemic affect in a different way the age classes. As you well know, seniors present more severe symptoms, or young children, adolescents have a low transmissibility compared to adults and seniors, and so on and so forth. The model that we use, that is in general used to model disease transmission, is a compartmental model. In compartmental model, any compartment is an health status, and in this case we have nine status, where the first one is a susceptible status. So basically any individual may be in a different status, depend on its health. If they are in a susceptible status, it means that they are healthy. Then they can move to the exposed status if they get in contact with an infected individual and they may be infected. So the exposed status instead is model the latency period, the incubation period. And in this model is in average 3.7 days. Then with a spontaneous transition, individual may move in the prodromic phase that is around in average 1.5 days. In the prodromic phase, individual are infectious, but they don't show symptoms. So then, after this phase, they can move in the other compartment and they can be asymptomatic, partially symptomatic, or instead they can show mild or severe symptoms. And this is depend on the age class. Then only people that develop severe symptoms, then they can move to the hospitalization compartment. And at the end of the dynamics, all the individual arrive in the recovered compartment. That is means that they are recovered or died. Then we develop the model for any region in France. And the information on the number of individuals in any region per age class was informed by demographic data. And the interactions among age classes used to inform the force of infection arrive from the contact matrix. Such contact matrix are empirical in the case of pre-pandemic condition and parameterize in the case we have to model particular interventions put in place by the government. Now I will show you how we use such model in a specific context. This was to quantify the under detection of cases in the exit of the first national lockdown in May and June. We decide to quantify the under detection in this period because as we are in exit of the lockdown, we expected that the social mixing increased again. And this increasing, if it's not controlled by a surveillance system, it may lead to a re-increasing of the epidemic. So it's so important to understand if the system is working, if the surveillance system is working. Before to implement the simulation, we had to parameterize the contact matrices, both in the lockdown and in exit phase of the lockdown. As you said, we had the contact matrix empirical from a survey conducted in 2015 in France. And this empirical matrix provide a number of contacts in different locations. So we have different contact metrics in household, workplace, school, transport, leisure, and other generic setting. Then in this survey, they provide also the contact metrics for physical and non-physical contact. Then all this, the sum of all these contact metrics resulting in the baseline metrics that I present here. Since the baseline metrics, what do we did? What do we Basically, we did a reduction of contact in specific social setting and targeted age classes to parameterize the social mixing in order to have a good approximation for the number of social contacts during the lockdown and in exit of the lockdown. This was possible using behavioral data. In fact, we used data from different sources. The first one from Google Mobility Trend. We used the variation in number of people in workplace for any region, and we used this information to reduce the contact at work. With the same idea, we use also the data from the Ministry of Education that provides in any region the percentage of the attendance in pre-primary schools and also in middle and high schools. And you use this such a data to reduce the contact in the contact metrics at school. Then proportionally, we also adjusted the contacts in the transportation metrics, because we reduce this as well, and we increase the social contact in the metrics in the household. Then we also parameterize the physical social contact from a survey of Sante Public Friends, that they provide the data on the percentage of people avoiding physical contacts in exit of lockdown. So we use such information to reduce the contact in the metrics that describe the physical contact. In specific, from another survey that provide that senior reduce in general more social contact in the physical contact compared to the other age class, we use also this information to reduce the 30% more the physical contact in seniors. During lockdown was more easy because school was closed, and so in this case we can put equal to zero contact at school, and also we assume that physical contact was equal to zero in any setting except household. Then, once that we had able to parameterize the contact matrices, we then simulate the dynamics. And first of all, we calibrate our model. The model was fitted on hospitalization data. We use hospitalization data as they don't have the bias on the testing, on the number of tests. As you can see here, I reported only three regions on the plot on the top, but we fitted any region. As we performed stochastic simulation, you can see we have our prediction with the median and the 95 confidence interval. And the point, the dot, they are the hospital admission in hospital data, are well reproduced from our prediction. Then we validate our model with serological data. So as you can see in the plot below, we see the percentage of the population infected over time, and this, and then we compare it with the red dot, that are the serological data that basically tell us the number of people that had COVID. And this data is well represented from our prediction. Then, once that we calibrate the model, we looked at the output of the simulation. So we were interested to understand the real number of infections in circulation in France after the lockdown. So we looked at the new symptomatic cases over time, as you can see in the plot A. I present the plot for overall France. And the white dot are the detected case cases instead, the detected cases by the surveillance system. And how you can see, they are deeply lower compared to our prediction. In fact, even if the positivity rate of the testing was lower than 2%, that is quite low. So it means that surveillance system is working. However, 90,000 of symptomatic cases have been not detected by the surveillance system between May and June. It means that the surveillance system were able to detect only 1 out of 10 symptomatic cases. And as you can see in the plot, the detection was computed as the ratio between the prediction, the detection and the prediction, and is the red in the red curve, the red curve, and this curve increase over time. So we have that at the beginning of May is around 7%, and then reach at the end of June around the 38%. Of detection, and this is trend is also presented if you see the figure B in any region. So we can say that for sure the efforts in the surveillance system were better week by week, but this is also due to the fact that the cases decrease over time. In fact, we found a relation. The following is a power relation, because we look at the relation between the detection rate and the incidence in any region in any week, and we found this power relation. That means that basically it's really important to test when the epidemic activity is very low. In fact, for example, is if you want to have a detection rate that is higher than 60% you are able to have it only if you have an incident that is lower than one symptomatic case per 100,000 individuals. It means that it's really deeply important that governments invest on testing strategy before that that the epidemic, the viral circulation in the territory increase. Then another important thing that I want to stress is also that from previous studies, researchers found that if you want to not put in place any intervention, you need to have a detection rate that is higher of 50%. And this is what not the case that that we experience in France at the end of June, as you can say. In fact, with the increasing of social contact during the late summer, what happened that we experience that basically the new infection start to increase, and we had a second wave. So this is an example of how to use a model for public health purpose. And if you have any question, I'm here to answer. Just to conclude, I want to thank all the members of my lab and my supervisor, Vittoria.
Thank you, Giulia, thank you. And are there questions or comments? I have one question concerning the movement of students. If I correctly understood, in the first study, you had no data concerning, let's say, students which are just moving from one area to another. Are there any type of these studies concerning categories of people, for example, student or specific? Because
We have it, the data that Orange provides us are for age class. So we have the information on age. I didn't present you, but we have the information per different hour of the day, different age class, and that's it, I think, yes.
And with this data, did you investigate whether, let's say, the transport from home to the school might have a role in the, in the spreading?
We have seen, for example, that there are a moment of the day that when the traffic are more reduced, that are the rush hour, that basically are the moment where people go to school, students go to school, and or adults go to work. And also the during work day was highly affected, the reduction during the day and the weekend during the night. So there are different patterns for sure, depending on the time and on the age.
Yeah. And this was introduced in some sense in some of the models or not? The fact that there was a kind of concentration in specific part of the day.
The model has assumption that we consider the region as an isolated system. So we don't consider movement among regions. And this was because basically with lockdown and the exit phase of lockdown was negligible, the new infections provided by this interaction, because they are more higher than the infection within the region. Then inside the region, we take in account the mobility inside the contact matrices. So implicitly, we model the mobility because you parameterize the social contact in different settings as school, work, transport. In this sense, we are able to model mobility. Instead, we use the mobility data from Google to reduce the contact at work.
There is a question or comment, so please go on. Guarino, there is a...
Hi, everybody. Hi, Giulia, and thanks for the nice talk.
Thank you.
Stefano Guarino from the National Research Council of Italy. So my question is about the model you presented in the second part of your talk. First of all, I want to make sure that I understood correctly. So you defined an epidemic model that also has an hospitalization case, and you fit your model to hospitalized people, and then you use the model to predict the actual number of infected. Am I right?
Yes.
Okay. So, how did you recover all the parameters of your model? And is this implementation of the model somehow accessible?
The parameterization of the model come from previous epidemiological studies. If you looked at the supplementary information of the paper, there are all the references of how we took the parameters. And what's the second question was?
So the probability of getting hospitalized, of infecting one another, and so on and so forth, all those data were taken from previous work.
Yes, exactly. And you can find it on, if you want, I have the on the slide the table with the information on these parameters, but you can find it on the supplementary, the reference of
And you implemented an agent based model in order to
no, it's not an agent based model, because we are we are in a, it's called social structure model, basically. For any region, we model social structure that basically are age classes, and any people in any age class, we have an assumption of homogeneous mixing. That is like the assumption of
infinity. So you use the differential equations to get the solution and the
in the continuous time, yes, but we did computational modeling, so basically it's a, with a stochastic approach. So basically, it's not properly, the system is described by a set of differential equations, but then the model was computed by simulation.
Okay, very last question, just very quickly. Do you have any?
Sorry, there is another question and we have not enough time.
Okay, I'm sorry.
There is Marzio, with, please.
Thank you very much. My name is Marzio Di Vece from IMI di Luca. You hear me?
Yes.
Thank you, Giulia. Given the talk, given also what Stefano Guarino said about hospitalization and that you used hospitalized data in order to estimate the infection, right?
Yes.
What is the concern about that also ISTAT did about excess mortality? So the people that are not hospitalized because there is no space in hospitals anymore, and so they just die at home. This this event that appeared in Italy, how do you take it to into account in your model or?
We didn't take into account at, we didn't need for our purpose for the our question, as we only need to feed the admission in hospital. So this is the data that we have it. Then, thanks at this feed, we looked at the infections. So we didn't care about the dynamics inside the hospital and what happens later. For us, was important only these things, and we didn't account for the people that death at home, as you said, without going in the hospital.
Without going in the hospital, yes.
Okay. We didn't take in account. I have to think better about that because I don't have a scientific reference to answer about the percentage, but I don't think it was relevant in percentage compared
to the Let's hope. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Julian, thank you to